chapter 21, verses 5 through 19. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'the time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues. And there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance. For I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our scripture lesson is Psalm 98. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gotten him victory. The Lord has made known his victory. He has revealed his vindication in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
He is good, he is above all things.
on the bookshelf in my office, not too far from that bell that makes a great backdrop for my Zoom calls. There is a copy of the score of Handel's Messiah. I have it because I didn't turn it in. That's euphemistically a word that I might have stolen it. I was in college choir for all 4 years. And every year at close to final exams and winter break, our college choir sang selections of Handel's Messiah. We'd invite choirs from churches in the community around us to join us in a mass choir to sing it. And every year as we rehearsed selections from Handel's Messiah, Dr. Cutno, our choir director, would tell us a story that had happened just a few years before, that they'd gotten together for the performance of Handel's Messiah, and as they were singing through the choruses and the solos, that in the back of the room, somebody was yelling from the back, "Sing! Sing the Messiah!" What the person back there was referring to was the Alleluia chorus, and had no patience for all the other pieces of music that were going to come before that. But she demanded, "Sing the Messiah! Sing! It's imperative." Here in Psalm 98, there is not a suggestion. This is not, you know, "Well, if you feel like it." It is actually, in the Hebrew, an imperative. Sing. Maybe it isn't expressed that way. Perhaps it might be differently offered in order to actually get you to do it. Sing a song, sing out loud, sing out strong, sing of good things, not bad, sing of happy, not sad, sing a song, make it simple, to last your whole life long. Don't worry that it's not good enough for anyone else to hear. Just sing a song." Y'all watch Sesame Street. All right. Yeah. Keep singing. That's all right. Keep going. Now, I recognize that a PhD music professor with 119-year-olds in front of him needs from time to time to say, "Sing!" And even in the little church I grew up in, I know some choir directors who came along for my children's choir and adult choir experiences who had to do the same thing. Sing! The imperative here in the psalm is sing a new song, which always has me asking, well, what was the old song? The old song was "Help!" And yeah, you can come. Let's get the Beatles section going. You need somebody. That's right. Help! Help! Although, to express that word in a more appropriate word, term for the Psalms, Hosanna is the word. Hosanna is the lyric of this song. And the word Hosanna means, "Lord, save us." Lord, save us. We've been singing the old song quite a bit, and we bring it back up as often as we need it. It's much like Christmas All the Time radio. And by the way, another station goes Christmas All the Time tomorrow. And all of them, but very soon. I went to Augusta, and it was Christmas All the Time there already. There's nothing, if the old song is, Lord save us, if the old song is Hosanna, that's one that we play on repeat. Sometimes it sounds like we're singing it all the time, but you know, there's nothing wrong with crying out to God for the help that we need. Matter of fact, it helps us realize that we can't do it all by ourselves. That probably the true test of our faith is that there are days when we really have to utterly depend on God, that we have to fully trust in God to meet our needs. Jesus blessed the poor. Say, blessed are the poor, or if you like the Matthew Sermon on the Mount, blessed are the poor in spirit, because that's a position in which there's nothing you can do for yourself. You are at a place where you utterly depend on God. And when we're trusting in God for everything, the blessing from Jesus is, you have the kingdom. The kingdom is yours. We are in a position to earnestly seek after God for all of what we need. We are in a position to depend on God for all of God's providential care. And Jesus teaches us about this. If you're searching for God, if you're searching for God's help, ask for it. Seek it out. Knock on doors. And what you discover in the asking and seeking and knocking is that God hears, that God cares, and that God answers. The story of crying out to God for help has been going on for quite a long time. If you take out the crying out to God for help parts of your Bible, you only have about 4 pages left. The index and the maps. In the Exodus, we see God's people enslaved in Egypt. And the first chapter of the book says, and they cried out to God for help. After the whole Exodus saga, you get to the book of Judges, and you will discover what is a very cyclical story there. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord raised up, fill in the blank, enemy to oppress God's people. And they cried out to God for help, and God heard them. And God raised up Gideon, and Samson, and Deborah, and many others who delivered God's people. And there was peace in the land. And then the story starts all over again. And that pattern tends to keep going through the reign of many kings in the nation. And then the nation splits, and that saga continues in the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, culminating with the bad news that Babylon came in and destroyed Jerusalem and the temple, and many people were taken away into exile. And here's something you need to know about Psalm 98. It was written after the exile. But we have another psalm that comes kind of from the exile, and the poet says, by the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and we wept. We hung our harps up in the willow trees. How could we sing the Lord's song in a different land? Generation after generation, we have even our own stories about crying out to God for help. We come to the Lord with our own needs. We have our own version of, Lord, save us. And yet, in the outcry, after all that stuff that we've been through, the psalmist comes back and says, we've heard you sing the oldies, but it's time to sing a new song. And here's why you should sing it. Because God hears, and God cares, and God answers. The Exodus story doesn't just, you know, tell you that the children of Israel cried out to God for help and God heard and God answered and everything was okay. You know, you've got this long story of the marvelous things that God has done because God heard that outcry and God responded with care and answers. And the same is true for that cycle of stories in the book of Judges. And that same is true for how God showed up when God's own people felt like, I would guess they felt relatively homeless, perhaps even orphaned from their own homeland and the places that were so familiar with them, even the places that they believed God lived, such as the temple. And you'll hear this on Christmas Eve, a story from the exile. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And yes, it's true for us as well. God has shown up in tremendous care. God has shown up with answers. And I have to say that that care continues. Those answers continue to come because something about the providential care of God that doesn't inoculate us against something bad happening again. We might believe that, but our own experience will tell us different. That we can tell a story about how we cried out to God for help. Chances are good that we're going to have to ask that prayer again. We're going to have to sing a song about help again. The Beatles didn't play it once. And so God comes back into our lives. God shows up again and again and again. And Psalm 98 refers to this showing up as victory. Now there's some story there. There are some literal victories that took place that had the people praising God and singing a new song about God being victorious. After the exile, it was that there were other world superpowers who were a little more victorious than Babylon. And thanks to Cyrus of Persia, everybody gets to go home. There's more to it than that, obviously. But even in our own lives, that circumstance of change has God pulling us out of darkness into light. And it is a victory. Yeah, there's a song. You hear that song, don't you? We can't sing Victory in Jesus because y'all sing it with a different cadence than I grew up with. So. Somebody goes straight rhythm on Beyond the Crystal Sea. It just drives me nuts. But the ultimate victory of God, it is true, has taken place through Jesus. His own name. Well, let's give you a preview of Advent. Matthew is told to name, Joseph is told in Matthew to name the child Jesus because he will save God's people from their sins. Jesus is the Greek version of the Hebrew word Joshua. There are a ton of kids named Joshua, weren't there? That name means God wins. That name means God saves. Yes, we have victory in Jesus. It's victory over, perhaps not in a way that we might imagine, because Jesus conquered sin and death by giving his own life for our sake. And that is why we sing. And that is why we sing. In the Lord of the Rings trilogy, in those big books that we prefer to watch movies, Tolkien writes about a quest. And it's a quest not so that the hobbits and the elves and the dwarves and the humans can figure out how to possess the Ring of Power, but that they would destroy the Ring of Power. Isn't that the essence of our faith? It's not about us wielding power. It's not about victory achieved through any military effort. But victory is achieved when we completely yield our own power to God. And so we have power through Jesus and the Holy Spirit, that we've been given a wisdom to perceive that with God, with Jesus, we see the world and our own lives in a very different kind of way. We come up with a new definition of what it means to win, what it means to achieve victory. We want to see the true power of victory, so we look to Jesus as our example. And how Jesus is wielding his powers, that he takes his hands and he touches lepers. We watch Jesus kneel down and wash the feet of those who would have gladly washed his. We watch Jesus surrender. We watch Jesus give up his own life. And we look at what Jesus did and we talk about how powerful is his love. We watch Jesus forgive the very people who would murder him. And we watch Jesus breathe his last breath, and then the miracle of seeing him alive again in resurrection. And all of that informs our singing of the new song. And what is it? What is the new song? I bet you know it. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Now you might say, wait a minute, that song isn't so new. Those are the old words and the old tune that I know very well. Alleluia is the Hebrew word for praise the Lord. And every time we come together for worship, we put an emphasis on prayer and praise being our first reflex in worship. And when we think about God, that is where we're supposed to be, in this attitude of praise and an attitude of alleluia. And yet sometimes we come into the presence of God and we get out our lists and we sing to the tune of help. Or we let God know all the big things we've built in his name. But the tune and the song, the new song to sing, has never been, "What have you done for me lately?" The song is, "How great thou art." Because further in the Psalms, we are told that we and the rest of the world, all of creation, has been made for praise. Read Psalm 148. The trees, the storms, the mountains, the birds, the animals, and all people, even young people and even old people. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If you lose your place during the responsive reading, just say praise the Lord. Maybe you catch up with us. Or maybe we stop and go, we've been reading the wrong thing. And we've got reason to sing. Here in Psalm 98, the reason is the joy of the Lord is your strength. There's a song about that. Yes, hallelujah is the old word. Let's not say that. Hallelujah is the ancient word. It comes to us from the depths of our faith. They sang it a long, long time ago, and it is still being sung again today. It is the new song. Yes, the words sound familiar. Yes, the tune might be exactly the same, but we sing a new song, and technically, it might be the very same song we sang a week ago. But we're the singers. And the reason the song is new is that because through Jesus, we are no longer the same. Through Jesus, we are transformed. We are different. We are being conformed to His image for the sake of the whole world. We are conformed to the image of Jesus for the sake of each other and for our neighbors. And so we're redeemed, we're transformed, we're delivered, we are saved. And our souls sing the old words to the old tune. But the song is different. The song is new because we're made new. And yeah, there's a scriptural reference I can pull out of Revelation chapter 5 that there are folks who are gathered around the throne, and John there says, and they sing a new song. Jesus is worthy to reveal to the rest of the world all of what God's will is about. And following that revelation that Jesus alone is worthy to show us what God wants, everybody starts singing the old song again. Hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. And thousands upon thousands, ten thousands upon ten thousands, myriads upon myriads sing the old words to the old tune, but it is a new song because they are made new. That's a sign of things to come as well as our present reality. Because when we lift up our hallelujahs and they come from our transformed souls, we sing a song that echoes through the centuries. It's a picture, it's a song about all of creation being created for praise. Now, as it was a long time ago, and in the days to come. And to that we sing, amen. So sing. I'm sorry, sing. Sing to the Lord a new song. We're going to sing, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Yeah, we've sung it before, but it's not the same old song because in Christ, the singers are different. And we thank God for that. Let's stand and sing together.